You wired me awake and hit me with a hand of broken nail. You tied my lead and pulled my chain to watch my blood begin to boil. But I'm gonna break, I'm gonna break my, gonna break my rusty cage and run. I'm gonna break, I'm gonna break my, gonna break my rusty cage and run. Too cold to start a fire, I'm burning diesel, burning dinosaur bones. I'll take the river down to still water and ride a pack of dogs.
We're up here in Kingsport on Willow Street in Borden Mill Village, next to the cotton mill, right across from Borden Park. So as a kid, you know, the park was awesome. We got to go to the park and participate in activities. Back then, it was always centered around kids. So we had a good childhood.
Me and Jess grew up like best friends. We always thought a lot of each other and took up for each other.
Early age, my father took me to watch some wrestling. So we went to Thomas Bennett, as a matter of fact, and we watched professional wrestling. Fell in love with it. So every Saturday night at midnight, it would come on. So I'd wait till my dad got home, we'd watch wrestling together.
That's what we watched. I was a big Superfly Snuka fan, I was. He's a big Ric Flair and Greg Valentine and all that, but they'd come to Civic Auditorium wrestle a lot. I think Valentine and Flair would wrestle there a lot. And that's way back. We'd go every time they showed up. Had Steamboat and all the guys. But, you know, like I said, later on in life, Jeff met most of them. Fulfilled a lot of his dreams. He's on that stuff. He didn't have me wrestle one time. Yeah, he came out there and hit me back of the head with a belt or something, knocked me down out in the middle of the ring. I wasn't expecting that. It was all fun, though.
He always sat back in the chair, you know, and he watched professional wrestling. He said, I'm going to wrestle them one of these days.
I always made jokes, I'm going to wrestle one day, and I'm going to do this one day. And at that time as a kid, I was just more or less saying, hey, I'm going to do that. Not really thinking that I would, but the dream of wanting to do it. So we'd make little rings in the backyard out of water holes and a cardboard wrestling belt, and some of the friends, we'd all wrestle around and everything. I think I was 9, maybe 10, I can't really remember. My father took me to, I played baseball, so we was going to hit some balls. And I remember I swung the bat and I heard something crack in my neck, and I thought, what is that? So next morning I couldn't get up.
When he was 9 years old, he had a kind of a benign tumor bone, and they had to replace bone marrow in his neck.
So they take me to the hospital. Well, when I get to the hospital, I go around to emergency surgery. Well, it was, I had a tumor on my bone, and it had ate through the bone, and they said within the next, if I hadn't got to the hospital when I did, I could have been paralyzed from my neck down. They said it was that close. So they went in, Dr. String, Dr. Malloy, and Dr. Nichols performed the surgery. So they put a wire in my neck, had to wear a brace for I don't know how long. I was in the hospital for, I think it was the first week we was out of school for summer vacation. And I remember coming out of the hospital and school started back the next week. So that's how long I was in the hospital. The doctor said I would never do any kind of sport. That for me, no, I wasn't going to listen to that. I was going to, you know, if I wanted to do something, I was going to do it. Of course, praying hard about it and then pursuing it, I did. But even through that time period, I'd always want to wrestle. So I can remember we was at my grandfather's in Blackwater, Virginia, and he had the barn and had the hay bales, and my cousin, Ellis, he wanted to wrestle, so I had the brace on. So I'm gonna drop, come off with the Randy Macho Man elbow from the top of the hay, you know, with the brace on. So I did. Hit my ankle, boom. So they're trying to carry him back to my dad and straight to the hospital. So the doctor says, well, the good news is the brace can come off. The bad news is I put a cast on his ankle. So I get the brace off, throw a cast on my ankle. So I think the week I got my cast off my ankle, the next week I was in school, Ross and Robinson, and we was wrestling in the gym, and one of the guys gave me the Ole Anderson, Gene Anderson slam on my arm, broke my arm. So here come my dad again, here I go, just had to cast off, cast on my arm, but that's just part of life, things as a kid. You just, you know, you got that drive, you don't think about that, you know.
He had a lot of broke hands and a bunch of stuff back when he's young. His leg band never did give up.
So I started working at Oakwood Market, and a gentleman named Earl Walters, who wrestled with Ron, Don Wright, Tony Peters, would come in the store. And I'd always ask him, I want to wrestle. And he said, how old are you? And I said, I'm 16. Come in when you're 18. So on my 18th birthday, I called Earl and said, I'm 18, which Mom didn't like it at all. Mom was like, you're not going to do that. There's no way. You can't do that. You're a neck. Mom, I'm going to try it. So I think Mom had called the promoter and was getting him a little lecture why I shouldn't do it, but I kept going. So the first day I went there, they beat the tar out of me. They just threw me around the ring and hit me with a chain and threw me out of the ring and just kept stomping on me. And the next day I went back, same thing.
I remember, you know, when he went to train with him as a wrestler. You know, he come in, my wife, she's aggravated by it because she said, Lord, he's done had all this. What's he doing anyway? She called Bud Adams, you know, and blessed him by about. She said, Lord, he can't do none of that stuff. But me, you know, I said, yeah, you can do it. You know, I was always that way because I always encouraged. And I remember one time when he, they went up there and he was training and they had flipped him over, you know, and slammed him to the floor, you know. And they said, if you make it through this, if you be back tomorrow, I know you're really interested. So he went back the next day. That's the history of that, you know.
After about 2 weeks of going back every night, and I mean black and blue and just sore, and my dad would say, son, what are you doing? You're going to kill yourself. I wanted to do it. So I remember I went back in. I pulled in the driveway one evening, and they were shaking their head. Tony Peters was there, and I said, well, I guess you want to wrestle, so we're going to start training you tonight. And I thought, train me tonight? What have you been doing, you know? But they back then, they didn't really want you to be part of the wrestling. It was a business that was sort of a family-type thing, and everyone was intertwined, you know? And they don't want outsiders in. And they was real strong in a word called kayfabe, to where if I was wrestling you, I wasn't going to talk to you at the arena. I wasn't going to talk to you in a supermarket or in a bar. We was a real thing, you know. So what we would do is the good guys be on one end, the bad guys on the other end, and we just knew we'd get in the ring what to do. We had that, you know, psychology of wrestling. This day and time, it's different. But how I started wrestling was that I started training, and I just kept wrestling and meeting people. My first big match was with Nikita Koloff in West Virginia. Started kicking off from there. And I remember I was at Domus Bennett one day, and I'd always told the teaching staff there, the coaches, Coach Wilson, and I think Graham Clark, and Brooks, I'd always tell them I was going to wrestle when I was in high school, and they'd just laugh at me, like, you crazy, Tankersley, you know. I'm going to wrestle the Rock and Roll Express here at Domus Bennett one day. I promise you I'm going to. Had that little gift of gab back then, too, so. Sure enough, they had booked me on an event, and I tagged with Ivan Koloff, and I was the Russian assassin with the red mask against the Rock and Roll Express at Domus Bennett. And just so happened, they was having a coach's staff meeting that day. So I thought, okay, I'm gonna bust that door open and walk in on them. So I went to the door, I opened it up, and I walked in and started staring at them. took the mask off. They, of course, they cracking up, but they kind of watched. But I did wrestle Rock and Roll Express at Dobbins Bennett, like I said I was going to.
Kingsport, Tennessee, that's right, Kingsport, Tennessee. Woo! We are about to make history because the Nature Boy returns. That's right, Friday, July 24th, the Nature Boy returns to Kingsport, Tennessee. Iron Ring Wrestling, that's right, Midnight Express, Rock and Roll Express, the Flair Boys, Jeff Tankersley, everybody's going to be in town. July 24th, Kingsport, be there. Woo!
I started my own promotion, Iron Ring Wrestling, IRW, and we ran Fun Fest every year and had great crowds. Brought Kane in one year, drew out 5,000 people at the Dome. Civic Auditorium, we'd pack it every Fun Fest. We had some good events. Names like Tony Atlas, the Big Boss Man, Sherry Martel, Jimmy Golden, Rock and Roll Express, Larry Zbysko, Tim Horner, Terry Funk, Dustin Rhodes, Goldust. I could name so many more. You know, we had Brad Armstrong, Bob Armstrong. So all those guys was in my organization, and I've got a lot of footage of that, which is great memories that we have. So after the wrestling, you know, I always wanted to start a business. Always dreaming, and this is going back after I got involved in wrestling. I was 18 years old, and at the age of 22, started working for Wells Fargo. Love the job. It's the first job I had that I really enjoyed. I mean, it's meeting people, and you was out and about, and I thought, I can do this. I can do this myself. So I went and checked on some insurance and things, and people would laugh at me. You can't do no armored car business. You can't, there's no way you can compete against Wells Fargo. I said, watch me.
When I was out selling the business, when I first got the insurance information, I was still working for Wells Fargo, and I would get off work and change into a suit, and I'd go out and sell. They got wind of it, let me go from Wells Fargo. My boss called me, I'll give you 6 months. Well, me being a little smarty, like I said, okay, 6 months, I have part of your business. Well, 6 months, I did have furious stops. They was kind of starting to come over to me.
So I've denied insurance the first few months, actually. And I remember my daughter's birthday, she was turning a year old. I got a call from an agent and said, we found a company that would accept you on your insurance. I thought, really? So I was friends with Wally Bowen, who owned Oakwood Markets. And Wally told me, you get insurance, come see me. So I went and told Wally I had insurance. So I started picking up his deposits.
We had a cousin worked in a metal fabricating shop, and I called him up and I said, listen, I need some steel sheets, some panels for I'm going to build a bulletproof van. What? Yeah, I'm going to build it myself because I... So anyway, he brought me, I think it was 4 sheets of 4x8 pig iron. And I got my dad's truck to haul it in.
I'm Shannon Castle, and I want to take this opportunity to tell you that me and Jeff Tankersley have been friends for going on 30 years now. I thought to myself, this fool has just come up with this harebrained idea, and there's no way that he's going to be able to do an armored car business here. He said, hey, I got a van, you know. I said, okay, is it armored? No, it's not armored, but I'm going to armor it. I said, well, how are you going to do that? I'm going to get this steel, this pig steel, just this rough steel, and I'm going to line the walls of this van with it. You know, I said, ain't that heavy? And he goes, yeah, of course it is, but I'm going to do it. So I'm thinking, how can this fool from Bordenville Village, okay, do this?
I remember well, I had a new truck at that time. I had a 93 GMC. And his ambition was to go into armored car business. He had worked a little bit with Loomis, with Fargo, you know. And so he decided he's going to do that. So he got his van and he armored his first van. And man, I mean, my truck low dolly sheet metal up. Went over and got it, and my truck was sticking right straight up in there. And I said, here I am with a new truck, and I'm going to break it down. I mean, my tire's about half flat on the back end. Drove that stuff in, and he put sheet metal in a van and built that thing, armored it through. I thought, well, how amazing, man. You know, I mean, you know, hey, he's doing things I could never do in my life, you know what I mean? But he did.
So then I need glass. So, you know, where do you get bulletproof glass at, you know? So there's an antique shop down in Mount Carmel. And I noticed there was an old bank, and they had bulletproof glass. So I walked in and asked them, hey, can I buy that glass and replace it with regular glass? Yeah, that's not a problem. So I bought that glass from them. Had a friend of mine work for Freeman Glass Service. I said, can we cut that glass? So we got a diamond tip blade. And sure enough, we cut that glass at the angle of the windows. So I put brackets in the door, and I bracket those windows in there and clamped them down, and had the bulletproof glass on the sides and on the front windshield. Well, the problem with that was the van that I had was a six-cylinder, and it could barely pull out of its tracks, but we could pick money up. So a few months went by, and we actually got a call from a vending company to pick up their money, which was Cohen. So we had bags of Cohen on top of the weight. So we was having a problem with the van pulling the weight. So I went and traded for a bigger van. And then I went to a metal shop, and they kind of bent the metal for me, and they adjusted it to where it fit better. And I had it done right from what I was going to want to do anyway. So anyway, we was up and going with the armored car. I think we had six pickups. Everyone laughed at me in the beginning, and they were still laughing, you know, because here I was in a homemade armored car, and I was picking up a grocery store and a couple of restaurants. Not making much money, but I get a free meal here and there at the Chop House and El Chico's. So Eastman Credit Union contacted me about servicing their ATM machines. I thought, okay. So I went and met with them, and the first part, we just did the change out, the paper change out, or we went in the bottom of the safe. We just worked on the problems, of the minor problems of the ATMs. Well, as time went on, I had a call from First American Bank. And they said, can you service ATM machines? I said, sure. Now, keep in mind, we only had one armored truck, had an office on New Street. All I have is a desk and a chair in this office. That time I had a partner with me, Andy Havolda, was working with me, a guy worked at Wells Fargo with me. So anyway, they were flying from Dallas, Texas to meet with us. I'm like, what? I said, okay, well, so we schedule a time. Well, of course, you know, image is everything. So I go and borrow a couch. I go borrow a computer. I have the office looking good. I had my aunt come by and sit at the desk and act like she was answering the phone and on the computer. Had my mom call the office every 15 minutes so the phone would ring. And two of my buddies wear their suit and ties, come in checking their messages. We looked big. Keep in mind, we only had a few stops. But I knew we had to look bigger to get that opportunity to service those machines. I knew we could do it. They fly in, they come in our office. Never forget it, because Andy, we got our uniforms on, and my partner Andy's sitting next to me, and got the insurance information out, you know, and the guys ask questions. And, well, can you raise that insurance to this amount? And I said, I think we can do that. He said, well, can we see one of your vans? And I said, well, I've called one off the route. And we only have one van. It's parked downstairs, the one that I built. And he's over there sweating. The guy said, I mean, we don't have time for that. I'll tell you what we'll do. We just wait, and we'll contact you back next week, and we'll go from there. They got to fly back to Dallas. So, yes, sir. So they leave. And he said, what are you going to do if they want to see a van? So I show them what we got. You know, I mean, we got to look bigger, you know, we got to get this account so we can do this if we get it. Anyway, the next week they call me back and they say, can you send me a picture of the van? Sure. Hang up. Call my buddy at Wells Fargo. Hey, Wally Van Hurst is his name. I said, Wally, you driving that armored van today for Fargo? Yes, sir. Come by my house when you get off work. He pulls up an armored van. I pop them doors open, take a picture of the inside of that van and the outside of my van. sent it to them. They called back the next week. Well, you got the contract. Here's the date you got to be this ATM machine. The first location was Gray at the old White's grocery store. They had the first American ATM machine. So we pull up. They having ribbon cutting and everything. Debo's there, a big ATM provider in this area. They show us a few things. Go in. I look at what he tells me one thing, tells Andy another thing, and they leave. And he goes, "You catch that?" And I said, "I got half of that. Did you catch it?" And he said, "Well, yeah." So I called a friend of mine who worked for the bank. Her name was Sally. "Sally, you service ATM machines. Now we hear this machine now. What do we push for this?" And she would tell me. So from that point on, we would see Debo parked at ATM. So we would just stop and go and watch him work on a machine. So we got so good at what they was doing, they would give us parts. And they would call us to go service their machines, and vice versa, we'd call them to service our machines if they was in an area we wasn't in, you know, to keep us from traveling so much. But that one machine turned into 378 machines, and we had the best service record as first provider of uptime, the machines being up, than any armored car service from here to Nashville. At its peak, we had 25 full-time employees, 18 routes, 25 vans, 2 armored trucks. We had Eastman Credit Union, Bank of Tennessee, First American Bank. We had Citizens Bank. We had Chop House. We had Cheddar's. We had Ross. We had Target. We had all these stops. I mean, we had it. And I ran the operations in. I had a good crew of people. And I think right now to this day, if I post something about Capital Armored on Facebook, all my former employees, best job I ever had. We loved you. I tried to take care of them, and I tried to work out in the field with them, and I tried to make it the best business. I was proud of that business, to start it from scratch, to see it grow, and see it be as big as it was.
Just to service your ATMs, Capital Armored Service provides a full-line ATM service, offering cash replenishment and on-call response team service for all ATM problems. Your employees are protected and won't spend valuable time away from your customers. We have full insurance coverage that can protect your ATM procedures. Capital Armored Service is now servicing the Knoxville area. Protecting you and your money is our business. Call Jeff Tankersley at 1-800-550-3443 for more information.
Andy had finally decided to do other things and be parted ways, and here I was all alone in this business and needed help and needed someone to come in to co-sign for some vans for me. So I had another business partner come in and do that, and the kind guy that I am, I gave him half the business for signing, co-signing for 2 vans. Really grew faster than what I thought. I mean, I was just a young kid. I was 24 years old, trying to figure this stuff out. But I knew how to take care of people. I knew how to service people and be able to be honest and do what I say. And that's why we grew. I took control of one side of the business and trusted everything else to my partner and everyone else. And it started being a downhill greed just started taking place, I think. And I'm not gonna say that I'm not totally responsible. I'm responsible as well for not watching what was going on, just trusting too much. This is 2007. We had a disagreement, my partner and I. We had a third partner actually with us, and we decided to dismiss my second partner from the business, and we did. Then it's like everyone just turned on me. I ended up trying to open another business up, a little restaurant, a little bar downtown, karaoke bar. I thought, well, I'll start this, and I may just leave this business and start another business here. And I think it leaked out that I was thinking about that. I walk in the office one day, and as I walk in the office, these two guys are there. These two guys asked a few questions, and I was arrested.
I received a call from Jeff one day. I was working, and he said, "Hey, bro," he said, "I just got out of jail." And I thought he was kidding. I mean, 'cause I thought to myself, there's no way in the world this guy right here would ever be in any kind of situation where he would be in jail. And I just couldn't imagine how that could happen. And he basically took me through step by step how the process that he went and got kind of tied up in. Even to this day, I don't know how it actually turned toward Jeff. Now, what you have to understand that there was a lot of times where, you know, different things, different business practices of partners and different things like this would kind of be different, you know. You know, sometimes you got to do things one way to get things done another way.
There was some money missing from the vault that I signed out. Their partner wasn't giving me any paycheck, and I was trying to support. I was going through a divorce, and things just getting real complicated in my life. To this day, I can tell you that I don't know why it went so crazy, because I really wasn't guilty of what I was arrested for. And a lot of people know that. They didn't come to my defense. A lot of people know that. But they thought they could take over what I started. You know, my integrity means the world to me, and people who know me know that. People who know me, they knew there's two sides of the story.
He was doing nothing more than what had been done before by other people in the company, and I knew that personally. And I just didn't understand it. But then Jeff said, I'm going to have to go to court. I'm going to have to be, you know, I've got to see this attorney, that attorney, you know. And it started really affecting Jeff personally, you know. It affected his mind, you know, and everything about his person. He was going down a dark path.
Depressing time, because I lost it all. I went from being 35 worth probably $1 million on paper to 38 to nothing. Just lost it all.
So when all this stuff happened with the armored car business, you know, I wasn't actually in touch with Jeff at that time, but I heard about it. And to be honest, if you know Jeff, it just went in one ear and out the other one. Like, you know, I knew that Jeff was an honorable person. I knew that that there was more to the story. Anybody that ever knows Jeff, you know, knows that Jeff is harder on himself than anybody else is on him, because he cares so much about people and pleasing people. So all of Jeff's friends know that Jeff cares more about what people think than what anybody else cares. You know, Jeff is just such a people-pleasing, happy person, and he loves his friends. He doesn't want to let anybody down, and that's Jeff's strengths, is that he is a great human being that cares about other people. And that's probably his biggest weakness, too. Jeff's a great person, and there's not anything I would ever hear about Jeff that would make me not believe that.
But during that time, I was still trying to find myself. I was depressed, because my integrity meant a whole lot to me, and people who knew me understood that there was a whole other story to this whole thing. But the people who didn't know me didn't know. That's what bothered me. But now I'm gonna take my responsibility, because instead of running from my ex-partner, I should have been confronting my ex-partner and taking care of my business. Instead, home trouble, work trouble, I ran to the nightlife, to the partying, to I'm bigger than life, I can do this, I don't need nobody to do this, I can do this. But God's got a way of pulling us back in. You know, God has got to bring us back in. So I was taught real quick that I'm not bigger than life, that I can be brought down like that, and I was. I was always worried about what people think of me, you know, and really all that really matters at that point is what God thinks of you. But at that time, I wasn't living that type of life. I'd opened a little bar up in the meantime, and the bar was going good, but I wasn't really watching the bar. I was just participating in the drinking and up late, and I was just partying way too much because that's my getaway. I was hiding from my problems through the good times. When all that trouble hit, I thought, well, am I being punished for, you know, selling beer to the public? Am I being, your mind just thinks different things. So I ended up selling everything I had in the bar for $2,500 and walked away from that. I'd still go to the bar in the evenings. And it's a guy named Richard Taylor. He would come in, he's always there at karaoke. He didn't drink anything, good guy. He invited me to church all the time. And I thought, well, yeah, okay. And I had no intentions of going to church. Then one evening he came in again and he caught me again. He said, you going to church tomorrow? Well, I said, Rich, I said, call me in the morning. I might go with you. So I'm laying in bed, the phone's ringing, and I'm ignoring it. I'm not going to go to church. Then I hear a knock at the door. I hear Mom open the door and say, he's back here in bed. He walks back in the bedroom and says, get up, you're going to church. And I'll tell you this, and that first day I went to church, it changed everything. That day, listening to that pastor talk, Greg the Priest was his name, and listening to him talk, I thought, man, I can do this. I can make it through this, you know. The song Johnny Cash sings is called The Beast of Me. We all have that beast in us that wants to come out. We got to keep that beast caged, because we all want to do things we shouldn't do. You know, we all have that. We all just, we're human, and we're going to make mistakes. But we got to remember to keep it caged. And what I want to do, my inspiration is I want someone to be able to see this story and say, well, you know, I can be a dreamer, but also to watch out for false friends, watch out for temptations. Keep your mind on what you're doing. Take responsibility. Don't run from your problems, because they're not going anywhere.
Good morning. My name's Brad Joseph. Currently the lead pastor at Rock Branch Independent Church in Nitro, West Virginia. But I've not always been a lead pastor, not always been a pastor. And I've known Jeff Tankersley going on now for close to 15 years. And first came to know Jeff in Tennessee through a good friend of both of ours, Ricky Morton. I lived with Ricky Morton for a period of time in the early 2000s when I was pursuing a wrestling career. And we became friends through Ricky. And then after, with beautiful Bobby Eaton of the Midnight Express, we were always around each other. And sure enough, at that time, Bobby was staying with Jeff for a period of time. And then me and Bobby, after me and Ricky Morton separated ways, we got together and got a place together. From the get-go, anybody that knows Jeff will tell you the same thing, that he's never met a person. He's never met a person, I don't believe, that he's not been friends with. The minute you know him, to know Jeff is to have Jeff want to be invested into you, want to know more about you. I mean, he wants to be a friend. He wants to be someone you can call him, someone you can rely on. And I can tell you, in the 15 years I've known Jeff, he's always been that. He's always been a friend from day one, even to now. He's been a friend. And even though that's his greatest strength, to some degree that can be his greatest weakness, because there are people out there that will use that strength to benefit themselves. And thus part, Jeff has been hurt by many people. He's been put in bad positions because of many people that he's put his trust in, that he's invested in, and then they've had ulterior motives. But, you know, God's greater than all that.
So I get a phone call from a family member that was actually trying to run my business at the time. And I'd say try, he was trying. And asking questions about insurance. So I said, and this time, I done started back in. A friend of mine named Farnell Raines had brought me in wanting to start another armored car service. And I was really down on that. I didn't want to do that, but he kept pushing me to do so. So we did. And I did pick up a couple of new customers. Well, I get this phone call. I'm like, you calling me after all I've been through and nobody was there for me and want me to answer questions for you on a company that I started, you know. Well, anyway, I said, well, maybe Farnell be interested in purchasing you or buying you out or whatever. So, made long story short, what happened was we took the company back over and started, you know, everything was the way I left it. I walked back in, so by God's grace, I got the company back. Got it back, it wasn't the same the second time around. You know, people had their doubts. People who knew me, they was all for me. Bigger people in the positions and the banks had read what happened and all this, so they wouldn't give me that opportunity to get back in that the banking industry as far as picking their money up at that time. So we get a lot of retail customers coming through. Find out when we went to title the vans were still in my name. So I'm having to sign the vans from my old company over to my new company. One van was still in my name, my ex-wife's name. So to get the business back was a big achievement for me. We worked it for a while, then a company came in and bought us out. And when they bought us out, I thought, what's next? You know, so we still had security on the side, so we just had some security contracts, and we got outbidded for those accounts, so we lost that account. So here I was right back, what's next? So trying to figure out what I want to do next, I thought about a medical waste pickup service, and I was trying to pursue that when my daughter gives me a call and says, Goodwill's hiring a manager from one of their stores. I thought, well, maybe it's something to do until I get this other business going. So I contact Morris Baker, who's CEO of Goodwill, and when I contacted him, he said, I want to talk to you anyway. I've got something I'd like to run by you. So I met with him, and it was totally opposite of what I went to talk to him for. It was loss prevention. So I just knew God was putting things in place at that time. So after about the third meeting with him, I decided to pursue a job with them. And the night before, I was nervous. I told my wife, I said, I don't know about this. You know, I said, honey, I said, it's going to be, I mean, I've not worked for nobody in a while. I've been my own boss for so long. How's this going to be? She goes, well, you don't have to stay. Just go and try it. So the first day I walked in, it was just like I knew that was a position for me. I mean, it's been great, and I've been there a year this month, November, and I already grew with the company. I started out with loss prevention, safety, and I've advanced into facilities management and logistics, and it's just one of those jobs that's getting my confidence back. I'm back out with meeting with people again, back in the community. So it's given me that second chance to really, I think, use my abilities and what I've learned of how to work with people. It's gave me that opportunity again.
My Goodwill did not have loss prevention in its 14 stores, and went and called Jeff one day and knew he was looking for a job, and asked him if he'd be interested in coming to work for Goodwill and work for me and start loss prevention up at Goodwill. And so that's how Jeff came to us. Jeff's got the characteristic to be able to take something and have no plan to begin with and develop that plan and get it up off the ground. And we needed loss prevention here at Goodwill. wasn't doing that, and went to Jeff and let him take his entrepreneurial creative spirit and his artistic spirit and say, let's craft a loss prevention department that we can help our employees succeed with. Jeff has that ability to take little direction and go with it, and the things he doesn't know, Jeff is able to be relentless at trying to figure out how to do it. So that's the characteristic with Jeff that drew me to him to work here, and Jeff's doing a great job for us. Jeff exudes hope, and we're an organization that works to provide employment or employment services for folks, and typically when they come to us, they're looking for that hope. And Jeff, just in talking with him, he exhibits it as a characteristic that he can instill. When he gets done talking with somebody, you feel that Jeff's poured into him a little bit and made their life a little better and provided that hope for him. So I think it's a characteristic of Jeff that, I knew that going in. Jeff and I had grown apart since school, but I knew with his background of working with the Armored Car Service and doing cash revisited and wrestling and the other things that Jeff focused on, you know, Jeff can take an idea and germinate it and take it to where it grows and produces fruit. So that's what I was looking for him to bring here, and all that is couched in hope. So I'm very proud to work with Jeff. You show him what a picture of success is, Jeff will take and create that success and make that happen. So creative adaptability, I guess, is the best way to describe Jeff. Yeah.
I'm still looking for my next thing. You know, I'm at Goodwill, but I'm still looking for that next thing every day to move up, to do better, to have better ideas, to make things better at work for the employees there, for my coworkers. You know, so I'm still looking for that next thing. I'm never satisfied. You know, I lay in bed at night and I think, how could I do this better? And I'm always thinking. And who knows what the next chapter is going to be, but I know that God's got it under control, and He gave me the knowledge to make it happen. So that's what I push for every day anymore. I get up and I thank God I'm healthy, and I thank God that I'm able to go out and do something, be productive. You know, get up and go. Don't lay down. Get up and go.
Now that I've come into ministry, I realize that Jeff is a true testimony of Romans 8:28, which is my favorite verse in the Bible, that all things work together for good to those that love God and are called to His purpose. All things. The best days when Jeff was at the height of his game, even his wrestling career and his business with Capital. And I worked with Jeff at Capital as well. He, once again, invested into me. I needed a job in between my wrestling shows, and he put me to work and gave me insurance and paid my way. But all things work together. So even the best of the best days to the deep and darkest days, which Jeff had some dark days, he'll tell you. He had some dark, dark days, but so thankful. Still know Jeff. Still thankful that he's still got a good testimony, and can motivate and can encourage others. I'm just thankful for Jeff. Thankful for all he's meant to me over the years, and excited that he's working with Goodwill. What a good man working for a good company. I'll tell you what. There's nothing but bright futures ahead with that team. But we're praying for you, Jeff. We're praying for your ministry, we're praying for your family, praying for your new position. Love you, buddy. Bye.
I think that was a comeback trail for him. And I have to say, I think Morris Baker and his dad is Reverend Wayne Baker, Pleasant View. And he called up Morris, and then Morris got him that job, you know. And I think he has done well in it, really has. So he's putting him back on his feet, you know, through all the obstacles and stuff, you know, that he's went through, but he's back.
It's changed his life. I think it's changing tremendously. Jeff's the type of person, every person he meets is a potential new friend. That's the way he is. Sometimes some of them friends probably took advantage of him, but that's the way he sees people. And I think the Goodwill has really got his confidence back. I think it's really changed his life in a big, influential way. I think it's really helped him getting some of the past off his mind and stuff. And I'm happy. It makes me happy if he's happy. He's done a lot of things people thought he couldn't do. I was good friends with Benny Wilson Band, which I used to hang out in the bars quite a bit, younger on. But the Benny Wilson Band, we was all at Rush Street one night, and there was a big crowd there. And I told Benny, I said, you let my brother sing some Johnny Cash. He said, you ain't kidding, can he sing? I said, I'm telling you, he can sing some Johnny Cash. He said, I'm gonna take your word for it. Well, he got up there, and it was a crowd at night too. And Jeff got up there and rocked the house. The whole place was clapping, going on. And that's really where Jeff first, you can ask him, but I think that's when he first got the inspiration to do this Cash Revisited, because he seen how the crowd, he got confidence that night. He said, well, people really like this. But I'll never forget that night. It was pretty good. He got up there and everybody was just cheering, going on. That's the first time in front of a bunch of people. Benny said, you're right, he can sing it.
Story's, I guess, unique. I have a Johnny Cash tribute band, and I started doing that in 2003, and I have opened up for Sammy Kershaw, Merle Haggard's sons, Ben and Marty, Ashley Campbell, Tommy Cash, Johnny's brother, performed in Nashville at the Hall of Fame, performed in Nashville at the Johnny Cash Museum, Arkansas at Johnny Cash's home place. I performed at Jerry Lawler, a friend of mine, a wrestler, his bar and grill on Bill Street in Memphis. So I've met a lot of people and through entertaining, and that's wrestling, through entertaining with that. And but as far as my life now, today, from the day to 5 years ago, things are different. A couple weeks ago, my mother had a child back in the 60s, and that child was given for adoption. And we don't know the reason behind all that and everything. And we knew we had a sister, but we didn't know exactly how to find her. We have a half-sister in Indiana, so my brother and I do. And we always talked about trying to find this sister that we had that we didn't know. Well, 2 weeks ago, on the Thursday evening, my brother's wife calls me and says, Jeff, Michael wanted me to call you. We got someone's messaged him on Facebook and we think it might be your sister. He was tore all to pieces. I thought, really? So we end up doing a group call, and sure enough, it's our sister. She found us. She actually had an attorney open the documents up, and that morning she got the paperwork in the mail, and she started doing Googling the obituaries, and she found our mother and the maiden name, and she saw she had two brothers. She thought she only had one. So when she contacted us, it was an emotional and happy emotional, you know. But I found out I was 86 at Thomas Bennett. She's 85 at Thomas Bennett. She was an Indian mascot, Donna's Bennett, all the pep rallies. I remember her very well. Ella Logan's her name. And, you know, she's every night since then, we've been talking FaceTime every night, so.
Oh, God. Let Michael go out there.
my story to be an inspiration to someone to say I can do it, or someone that's going through what I went through. Hey, it can get better. You know, you got to drop on those knees. You got to admit that you're wrong, and God can bring you out anything. And I know that's true because I'm proof of it. Everybody says, boy, your life has been exciting. Well, yeah, it's been exciting. They think it's all glamour. They see all these videos of me wrestling and me singing. They think, well, he has it all together. Well, really? I mean, I didn't have it all together. I was blessed to meet the people I've met or sing with people I've sung with and wrestled the guys I've wrestled. But I was still yet, I wasn't where I needed to be. And I think that things happen to bring you back where you need to be. That's what I'm working on. I want to be a good father. I want to be a good grandfather. I want to be a good brother. I want to be a good son. I want to be a good husband. I want to be all these things. And I want people to see in me that you can be successful and that you can keep going through hard times, because hard times is there. Without hard times, it wouldn't be good times, right? I'm back to level, that's back down to the ground level again. Which my wife, Tammy, I mean, during this process of getting back on my feet, she was always there for me. I mean, she was there. She was my biggest fan as far as supporting me and trying to help pull me out of the gutter and give me advice and give me lectures. But she's always been there through the, you know, through the hard times, through the good times. I've got two beautiful daughters, Haley and Elena, and a grandson, Rylan, and a goddaughter, Santana. So things came back around, but it took a while for them to get there, you know. Everything's coming together in my life, it seems like, and I think, you know, God's got a big part of that, and I just want people to know that you can't give up. You have to keep going. And at one time in my life, I was down, and I didn't want to keep going, but I was pretty much down, rock bottom, the wall, wasn't going to keep going until I went to that church that Sunday, and it just opened my eyes up, and I've just kept pushing. I have a cousin of mine always told me life's a four-lane highway. If you lay down, no one's going to go around you, they'll go over you. So you have to keep going. So I try to keep going. Even the times I'm not feeling it inside, I still smile and you would think I got it all together, and really inside I don't. And there's still days that I fall back and I worry and I look at things, but as far as life today, I think each day is getting better and better, and that's thanks to God and thanks to my employment, thanks to my family and all my friends. I've been blessed with a lot of good friends. And I just try to be good to people. And that's what my dad taught us that, and that's what I try to do.
There we go. If I can remember that there, I can get it. Let's try it again.
Now listen, you're burning up all kinds of tape.
I know.
It's thousands of dollars going by.
I know it. Thank God Kenyon's my buddy. All right.
Here we go.
Hey, when you're ready, Kenyon, we'll
clap. Yeah.
The beast in me is caged by frail, fragile bottom. Restless by day and by night, rants and rages as the stars. God help the beast in me. Oh, the beast in me has had to learn to live with pain.
and how to shelter from the rain. And in the twinkling of an eye, might have to be restrained. God help the beast in me. Sometimes it tries to kid me that it's just a teddy bear, and even somehow manages to vanish in the air, and that is when I must beware of the beast in me. That everybody knows, they've seen him out dressed in my clothes, patently unclear if it's New York or New Year. God help the beast in me.